Good morning, everyone. Welcome to another community conversation. It's February 12th of 2024. I'm Robin Shapiro. I'm Board Chair Emerita, and I'd like to welcome you to our call today. We always start with a safe space statement and land acknowledgement. And So I'd like to establish this meeting as a safe space, and that means that everyone's voice will be heard and respected. And we enter the space today with different lived experiences, and as such, we recognize the potential for unintentional harm, and we as an organization are committed to healing should harm occur. And I'd also like to just take a moment to think about the land that we are on and who just give respect and a moment of thinking about the unceded land and acknowledging the people, the original people on which we play, work, and are, and pay our respects. So wherever you are, I'd like you to think about that. So let's go ahead and get started today. We have Dr. Chris Price, who we're very fortunate to have as one of our Health Advocate X board members. He's a retired cardiologist. You've seen that in the bio and the information that we've had going. He's going to first give us an update on some public health issues, and then we're going to use the next session of our community conversation to look at women's heart health. And we have a lot of really interesting information. When we did our prep call on Friday, I learned a lot of things. So I think this is going to be a great session. So glad you could join us. And I will turn it over to Chris.
Hi, sorry, I guess you have to stumble the first time you speak. Good morning, everybody, or good afternoon, depending on where you are. Just to kind of go with the format that we've had, we'll just do a little bit of updates on kind of some health trends, primarily COVID and RSV and flu, which is this kind of on everybody's mind and has been for several years. Right now, the COVID trends are actually trending downward. In the last 2 weeks, we have a trend of across the country of 11% drop in COVID ER visits and hospital admissions, which is good to hear. The only part of the country that's lagging a little bit is the Southeast, but that's also where we're lagging with vaccinations down there, so it kind of goes hand in hand. In terms of RSV, we also are at a low turning point. The peak of that was the week of the last week of December, which is typically what it has been for the last 30, 40 years. It kind of starts coming up in November, October, November, and then disappears by April. And we are still following that bell curve and is diminishing. And it is low right now in terms of hospital admissions and being tested positive for. Flu is low in most of the United States with the trends dropping down. But unfortunately, the Southeast is also where that's lagging. In terms of other health things, one thing that I wanted to bring up is if you're going to Europe, there is a measles outbreak there, which is primarily due to younger children not getting vaccinated during the pandemic. And if you're going over there, it's always good to check to see if you need to get a booster. We typically don't do that, but it's always a good thing with the with there being an epidemic over there right now. So those are most of the health updates of what's going on. And so unless anybody has any questions, I will get into the heart disease in women portion of this.
I think that sounds great. And if anybody has any other questions about COVID or RSV, just go ahead and throw them in the chat and we can connect on them after Chris goes through his prepared comments. Thanks, Chris.
No problem. So heart disease in women. February is heart month. It's wear a red dress month. There's plenty of doctors wearing those pins. I used to wear one all year long when I was actually practicing. Why do we talk about heart disease in women? Well, it's number one killer in women. One out of four women will die from heart disease. So it's something that we should pay quite a bit of attention to. Traditionally, when we talk about heart disease, we're talking about the blockages of the arteries to the heart. Traditionally, what people are told and what we're taught in school and things is that when you present with blockages of the arteries, people will usually develop substernal or mid-chest pain, tightness, pressure, which can radiate down your left arm and radiate into your jaw. It's usually associated with shortness of breath, where you feel winded or you start sweating profusely. One of the classic examples of that, if people are old enough to remember Sanford and Son, you had Red Fox always screaming, "Elizabeth, this is the big one." That was kind
I
of
remember
just
that.
just kind of a classic one. But what's really interesting is that women present very differently. We have stereotypically have presented that heart disease presents the way men present. And that is how men present, is the typical way of chest pain and things. Women, on the other hand, present mostly with shortness of breath with exertion. When there's no real chest pain. Some do, but the majority of them do have more shortness of breath, fatigue, and also they tend to have more pain between their shoulder blades than in their chest. That's really the biggest difference.
And what does that pain feel like?
It's like a belt being tightened between your shoulder blades. So it can feel like a muscle being pulled or you reached somewhere differently. It's very different than the classic kind of elephant sitting on your chest that they describe for men and things, but it's more of a pulled muscle tight belt across your shoulder blades. But it never comes to the front for whatever reason. And that tends to have doctors, if you go to the emergency room or talk to your primary doctor, say, "Oh, this is probably just pulled muscle," or "the shortness of breath and fatigue is because of you're out of shape, you're getting older," or people themselves can actually start thinking that and not mention it. So that's one of the problems. The other problem that we find that with women and heart disease is that medicine has always said that estrogen protects women. And we don't really need to worry about heart disease until 10 years after they go into menopause, which is not true. it's a trend. It's just something that they've said, and it's just wrong.
But there's no data to support that.
No data in the past, but recently more data has come out to say that that is not the case. As Robin posted on LinkedIn, there's a Maria Shriver article, which I can post in the chat in a little bit, that has five female cardiologists that have kind of done a lot of research in the last 5 to 10 years on this that have shown that it's very different. So most women are not told to get their heart checked. That's why I thought it'd be a good reason to start saying you should. And also kind of look at the new data that's come out. It shows that there's different risk factors for women than for men that we really need to be kind of taking a look at. And women should be thinking about that and also stressing to the doctors to get things checked. Let's go with the standard risk factors for blockages of the arteries. You have age. Anybody over the age of 65, not one we can modify, but it is one. Family history of someone having a heart attack. And by family history, a lot of people think that, oh, their grandmother had a heart attack in their 70s or 80s, or their grandfather had one. That means that I have a family history. That's not true. That family history, we don't really consider. What we're looking for in terms of family history is people under the age of 50 years old that have a heart disease or heart problem. That is much more, because that usually will mean that there's a genetic component to it or something of a lifestyle component that can be modified and something that needs to be looked at. High blood pressure is a risk factor for both men and women. Diabetes, either type 1 or type 2. Type 1 tends to be more severe. And what most people don't realize is if you've been diagnosed with diabetes, we presume that you already have heart disease. Because people with diabetes tend to have the same occurrence of heart disease as people with previous heart disease. So that's the reason we consider that. Smoking is the number one factor that causes heart disease. It's actually worse for women to smoke than for men. If you were to look at all modifications of risk factors, you can reduce your blood pressure, get it controlled, your cholesterol, and all the ones that we can control in terms of you reduce your risk by 10%. If men quit smoking, they reduce their risk by 50%. If women quit smoking, they reduce their risk by 75%. So it's a significant thing. And we only started noticing this when women started smoking, the advertisement started going towards women with the Virginia Slims back in the late 60s, early 70s. And that's also when lung cancer took over for breast cancer as the number one cause of cancer death in women. So that's just, increased cholesterol is another risk factor, and obesity. But the new risk factors with the new research that's come out is that one is autoimmune disorders. That actually causes increased inflammation in the body. And why is that important for women? Well, 4 out of 5 people that have autoimmune disorders are female. It's much more related to that. And there was a new recent article that said that that this might actually be because of, there's an article in Nature that just came out last week that showed it might be masking some of the proteins that are formed on the X chromosomes. Since women have 2 X chromosomes, that might be why they have more autoimmune disorders.
That's interesting.
It was very interesting.
Yeah. And I wanted to let people know too, that I just posted that article on the Cardiologist's excellent article that actually you found, Chris, from Maria Shriver's Sunday paper. So I posted that to the chat if anybody's interested.
Well, thank you. Other new risk factors. One of the biggest things that we are finding is that gestational history or your pregnancy history is really important for women, and more doctors need to ask about it. Because what we're finding is that people that have had preeclampsia during their pregnancy, which is high blood pressure, possibly seizing, depending on the extent of it, they're at increased risk of developing high blood pressure later in life and also increased risk for having heart disease. Gestational diabetes is another one that people that have gestational or women that have gestational diabetes tend to develop diabetes later in life and tend to have more risk of heart disease. The other one that's interesting is radiation to the chest as a treatment for breast cancer. This actually causes a problem within the artery and also in the valves of the heart. And more women have radiation because of breast cancer to their chest than it causes actually heart disease at a younger age, since we're having breast cancer younger. And then the final new risk factor that they're saying is that either having premature puberty or premature menopause increases your risk of having heart disease.
And what is what does prematurity mean?
Starting before the age of 8 for puberty, and then starting menopause in your 40s.
Okay. So wow, 8, that is really young. Yeah.
Yes.
That is really young.
Yeah. And so one of the doctors in the article that that Robin has posted, Dr. Jane Morgan, puts it that pregnancy is actually the first stress test for women. And if you fail that, either with preeclampsia, gestational diabetes and things, you really need to have your health monitored and checked more often because you are at risk of having heart disease. So those are the new risk factors. And I think that those are really important. I can take a break here with that, because then I'm going to go to outcomes of heart
disease.
Yeah.
And Michael Wood, also a board member, asks, with the drastic reduction in smoking over the past 50 years, what is the research saying that the replacement causes are for women? And he says overweight and diabetes increase since 1980 come to mind. Yeah, that's a good question, Michael. Thank you.
Smoking has gone down, but people are also vaping more. And we don't know anything about vaping. I would assume that it's going to be about the same in terms of a risk factor, if not worse, but uncertain at this time. There's no documented research that shows that that's actually worse or better or neutral compared to smoking. So I can't comment officially on that.
And what about long COVID? Yeah, good question, Kate Smith. Some symptoms have been short of breath. Does this imply heart involvement?
In terms of long COVID, the shortness of breath and things, most of what we're seeing with long COVID is either because of clots. It's not because of blockages being formed in the arteries of the heart. The shortness of breath is mostly because you're having blood clots they think are embolizing to the lungs themselves. And that's what's causing the shortness of breath and allowing people to become more out of shape and takes longer to recover because of the damage done to their lungs than from actual heart disease. With COVID, there is the thing with myocarditis, which was an article that came out of Ohio State. I always question people that bring up that article, because the biggest problem with that article is that we have no other data that shows that flu or RSV doesn't cause the same amount of myocarditis found by MRI, because they didn't do it by the typical way of looking for elevated troponin, which is a blood test, and a wall motion abnormality on an echocardiogram or an ultrasound of the heart. And that was the typical way of determining myocarditis before. They just did MRIs. And so we just don't have a comparison between influenza or RSV or other viruses to see if that's the case also.
So Margaret Buckley Brown, sorry about that, Margaret, asks, for many heritable connective tissue disorders, cardiac symptoms, surveillance are heightened. How does this affect general population who may not have this diagnosis of heart issues?
That's a really good question. I honestly don't know. I will have to look that up and I can get back to you guys.
And I'm kind of curious. I mean, you did mention a bit about inflammatory conditions, autoimmune conditions, which we're learning more and more is kind of like this overlayment of everything. So if you have autoimmune condition, does that put you at greater risk for heart issues? And how do we know the mechanism or?
The mechanism is increased inflammation within the body. And what we're finding out is that blockages of the arteries are caused by an inflammatory state within the body. And so anything that can increase that inflammation can increase your risk of heart disease. It is kind of just a simple answer for it.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Super interesting. I mean, I find that that article and what you've said this morning is really different than I think what I've heard, what's in the general public about heart disease. So thank you.
Yes. And no problem. And so in terms of outcomes of heart disease, typically what we've found, or typically what medicine has stated, is that women have worse outcomes with heart disease. I'm going to say this is not my term. This is what I was taught when I was in medical school and in cardiology, is that the reason for this was that we've treated women as small men when it came to treatment for heart disease. What do I mean by that? Well, smaller arteries tend not to the smaller stents that we put in hearts tend not to last as long. If it's a small artery that we bypass, it tends to not last as long. And
why
we just
is that?
It's something to, the technical term is Bernoulli's effect. It's a physical or physics term, but to have a larger flow tends to keep things from blocking up. It's just kind of the same thing with pipes and things like that. That just the stents tend to close when they're smaller. The range that we're looking at is 3 millimeters in diameter or more tend to be better, if you want specifics. And that's just what it is. And it goes all the way up to 4.5 millimeters. So that's typical size. But women before with all this was that they weren't exercising as much, but we can actually improve our size of our arteries by exercise. And so with the new exercise things, I believe we should see a change. But that's the thing. But in reality, you know, the other reason for women not doing well in the past is something called is just a late presentation. Because their symptoms are different, people blow it off. Doctors blow it off. They feel it's anxiety is what a lot of women are told initially. And this just needs to have a complete mindset change within the medical field. There also is a later presentation for something called caretaker syndrome, which women tend to be the caretakers for their elderly parents, their or for their kids, and they postpone going to the hospital. When I was practicing, we would see this with everybody, either the day after Christmas, the day after New Year's. They would come in if they would have, because they didn't want to break up or disturb the family dinner.
Wow.
They waited an extra 8 hours. And my comment to them was, if you actually would have disturbed the dinner, you would be leaving today. Now you're going to be here for 3 to 5 days instead. And you're going to have a worse outcome because there's damage done. And
wow,
the biggest
that's
thing
dramatic.
The longer you wait with heart disease with a blocked artery, the more damage is done. And so we really say time is muscle when it comes to heart disease. And the sooner you get in, the better off you are. And we call it the golden hour. If you can actually get in within the first hour presentation of or present presentation of your symptoms, your risk of having heart failure and bad outcomes from this is actually reduced significantly. And every hour after that, it drastically goes down exponentially. One of the other reasons why women have had in the past worse outcomes with heart disease is that they weren't encouraged to do cardiac rehab. Cardiac rehab is one of the best things for people that have had either stents, heart attacks, or bypass surgery. What's interesting is if you look at people that have done cardiac rehab, who get the best benefit out of it? Women who do cardiac rehab actually do the best out of all of both sexes. Then it goes men that do cardiac rehab. Then it goes men that don't do cardiac rehab. And the ones that do the worst are women who don't do cardiac rehab.
Can you give us a sense of what cardiac rehab is?
Cardiac rehab is basically, it's going to the gym where you're hooked up to a monitor and you have a nurse watching you exercise. And they slowly build it up over time and it gets you comfortable to get back and do things. And what it improves balance, it improves stamina, things like that. And it gives kind of a safety net for people to first do it after having their heart attack or having stents and bypass. So I've always encouraged people because, and the other thing with cardiac rehab is that post-event depression is significantly reduced when you do cardiac rehab. The way I used to explain that to my patients was that the human mind, and this is going to sound a little weird, but the human mind is a little sick. And that when you go to cardiac rehab, you find someone doing worse than you, and it makes you feel better.
Wow.
That's just the way we are. And it really is true because you talk to people afterwards like, yeah, there was someone worse that made me feel a lot better that I could do this and I was doing better than someone else. It's just that competition kind of thing.
Or maybe even seeing somebody who had been progressed and know that your situation is not you know, forever.
Yeah, that you will get better with time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And then the other one that's really interesting is, and we'll hear more of this next month with our speaker who's going to talk about menopause and perimenopause, but perimenopausal estrogen is actually being more of a beneficial thing for women in terms of preventing heart disease. It gets their cholesterol, it keeps their HDL high, it makes them feel better, it keeps them more active, all these different things. And what's interesting is that the original study that was done to see if postmenopausal estrogen would be beneficial was all done on men, not on
what? Women. What? You're kidding.
No, women have been left out of research for a long time because of the hormonal changes that happen month to month. And
right.
The original study that was done back in the 50s was done on men, and it showed no benefit. It actually showed worse.
On men,
I don't know.
Yeah, that's strange. What about the
crazy
research, the long time research on, you know, estrogen replacement therapy? There's been lots and lots of studies on, I think it was like Premarin or Prempros, or I can't remember which one was which.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that our speaker next month is going to be talking more about. She's going to go all into that. So I will leave that to her, to be honest with you.
Oh, okay.
But it does benefit heart disease. It does prevent it for women, and for multiple reasons, from feeling better, being exercised, being less fatigued, less brain fog, and all those things. Plus keeping their cholesterol better from a heart perspective is also better. So I think it's just something that we need to do. But one of the things I would really strongly encourage all women to do in terms of heart disease is talk to their primary care doctors, talk to their doctors and say, what's my blood pressure doing? What's my cholesterol doing? You know, get them to actually engage and think about it, because I think we need to make a difference, change the opinion that it's not just for old women. No, it's happens in women in their 40s and 50s. And we need to be, the best way of putting it is you have to be your best advocate. And, your own advocate is the best way to do this. And you have to ask. And if it makes it a little uncomfortable in the doctor's office, that's okay. It's beneficial to you. And that's what really is what they're there for, is to be a benefit to you.
So, Chris, are we going to also get into heart disease, especially in women of color?
So, yes, thank you. I'm sorry. So with the new risk factors that are brought in, what we found is that more women of color tend to have preeclampsia or gestational diabetes, and they're not they're being treated for it, but they're not being told that that's a risk factor for heart disease later on. They also tend to be more obese. They also tend to have higher blood pressures and things like that, even without the preeclampsia. So it's really a factor, which is pointed out in the article that you posted from Maria Shriver, that women of color actually tend to have more heart disease because of these risk factors that happen during their pregnancy times. And it's not looked at, it's not considered a risk factor, and so it's not studied. And so that's really where the diversity and inclusion needs to be brought in also.
Mm-hmm. And as a woman of a certain age and cholesterol creeping up myself, when you talk about blood pressure and cholesterol and, advocating with your doctor, I'm kind of curious if you're just kind of monitoring all those things at one point. Is that becoming problematic, or is it just bringing up the certain questions with your doctor?
I think you start at a young age and just keep asking and just make it a routine, or every time you go in, you ask, okay, is my blood pressure in the normal range? Is it 120? 120 to 130 is the upper limits. We'd like to see it 120 or less, but not less than 90, because then you start having problems with passing out. And the bottom number with the high blood pressure, we only worry about how high it goes. It doesn't matter how low it goes, because a lot of people will say, oh, you have a really low number on the bottom. The lower it is, the better off, because that's actually when your heart's resting. And so that actually is better for you. We worry about when it creeps above 80. And so that lower number needs to be less than 80. In terms of, you know, cholesterol, we'd like to, you know, the HDL above 40 actually is great. And that's what estrogen does. A lot of women who are not in menopause tend to have an HDL in the 60s or 70s. So it actually is beneficial for them. Sorry, I'm having a little problems. My computer is freaking out a little bit, so I'll just ignore that. But as they get older, that HDL will come down. But still, at the same time, we don't know if having a high HDL and a high LDL is that good or bad. There's no studies really showing that. And that's one of the things that we need to have discussion. A lot of people think statins are the worst drugs because they have symptoms and things. Actually, statins are great. The biggest benefit from a statin is not from lowering your cholesterol, but it's an anti-inflammatory medication. It actually brings down your anti-inflammatory. It brings down the different inflammatory markers that we see, and it's actually beneficial. So
protective. Yeah. Yep. I remember a long time ago, I was talking with a bunch of rheumatologists, and one suggested that they should put statins in the water, that it would just be helpful for everyone to have that overall.
Yeah, we used to joke about that at the VA when I did my residency. We should put an antidepressant and a statin in the water of the VA and just treat them all, because they all were on it already. So
yeah, incredible. So encouraging everybody to post questions in the chat. We have one from Maggie Pheasant, who asks, what is the range for LDL?
Okay, so if you have no risk factors, LDL should be less than 120. If you have risk factors, we'd like to see it less than 100. And the higher, the more risk factors you have, the lower we'd like to have it go. The goal right now is, if you have heart disease or blockages of the arteries, we'd like to see it less than 70. I usually treated people, if they had two or more risk factors, get your LDL less than 70, and do it that way. Is there any proof behind that? No, but we do know that the lower your cholesterol is, the less, or the lower your LDL is, the less chances you have for recurrence of heart disease episodes. And it's just a matter of whether or not you can tolerate the medication and things. And the price of statins has gone down significantly in the last 10 years. So that makes it a little bit more accessible. Because back in the 90s, they were $200 to $300 a month for a prescription for statins. Now, most insurance plans, it's $4. So that's a good thing.
Chris, can you prioritize risk factors for folks? Like what are, you know, first of all, what are they, and then how you would list them out in high risk, less high risk, lower risk?
Well, the highest risk, the way I would put it is age, which you can't do anything about. You can't change that one. Modifiable ones, the highest risks are diabetes and smoking. Those are the two, because with diabetes, you're assumed to have coronary disease or heart disease. So that's probably the highest risk. Smoking is the only one that we can really modify. And so it's the best one to really change. But those are the three probably highest risks. Family history of someone, especially if they have someone that's had a heart attack under the age of 40, is also a high risk. But there's not much you can do about it except for modify the other risk factors. And then with the new ones, you know, making sure your blood pressure is controlled, I put that more of a moderate risk compared to the other ones. And then with autoimmune disease, it's probably a moderate risk also, but it's, again, modifying the ones you can change. And so that's where it goes. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, thanks. I was actually also curious about weight, but contributes to all of those, right? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, with weight, you tend to have diabetes. So you put the diabetes first, and then, but if you can modify your type 2 diabetes and get that under control. The one thing I would also stress, which I like to stress with people, is that even if you've had type 2 diabetes that's diet controlled, and your A1C is less than 6, which is a number that it's a 3-month trend of what your sugars have been over the last 3 months. They say you don't have diabetes that moment if your hemoglobin A1C is less than 6. If you've had a history of having type 2 diabetes, I, as a cardiologist, always treated you as if you still had diabetes. And we needed to treat your cholesterol, get that down, just because it's a modifiable risk that it's, you know, you're modifying, you're getting your sugars as best controlled, but still, I considered you to have diabetes in terms of my mind, in terms of treating and, you know, doing that kind of stuff.
So if somebody's healthy other than having a high cholesterol score, would you treat with a statin, and what is the potential side effect of that?
I would still treat. The biggest side effect to that is muscle pain is what's usually described. It's a myositis, or an inflammation of the muscles that happens. It happens less likely than most people, or than what is believed. It does cause some kind of fatigue, but the benefits for it personally outweigh the effects of the statin. Also, there are studies out there that show that if you take a statin, you reduce your risk of having dementia later in life. So it's a double benefit. And there are some homeopathic, like red yeast rice, or red rice yeast, I'm sorry, which is just a natural statin. And some people take that instead of the pharmacological ones. Also, the other thing is that we used to say take a statin at night before you go to bed, because that's when the body produces cholesterol in your liver. With the new statins, you don't need to. Just take it in the morning with all the rest of your pills, if you take pills. Just take it every day, because the half-life is over 18 hours. It doesn't really make that much of a difference. The original statins that came out had a half-life of 4 hours. So if you took it in the morning, it wasn't there at night when your body was doing that. Now it is with the new drugs.
So question from Linda Dahl. Hi, Linda. Someone who had gestational diabetes 50 years ago, but no other diabetes indication, are they still at higher risk? 50 years ago. Okay. Roseanne Gazelle, what about stress and anxiety as a risk factor? So the mind-body connection, how strict do you have to be with the diet?
In terms of stress and anxiety, I think it's the way I've always explained it to patients, and I don't have any proof for this, but I think it's what you do during the stress and anxiety in terms of how you comfort yourself. Is it smoking? Is it overeating? Is it, you know, not exercising? I think those are the things that cause heart problems to happen in people that have stress and anxiety. More than just the actual state. Could it cause an inflammatory state? It's possible. I don't know of any research that shows that connection per se. So that's what I would say to that.
So Michael Wood said that statins double the chances of developing type 2 diabetes versus no statins.
It's a causation versus correlation point. And we don't know if it's a correlation or a causation. I think the benefits for being on a statin have been shown to outweigh that risk in terms of heart disease.
Kate Smith says, my mom and her 3 sisters all had congestive heart failure. is there anything I can do for preventative, or is this one of the inevitable aging issues? And can you repeat the word, what is looked for in the lungs to diagnose long COVID?
Oh.
So the first one is age-related.
Age-related congestive heart failure. Yeah. So congestive heart failure is not always caused by coronary artery disease. So the talk today is about blockages of the arteries. Can blockages of the arteries and having a heart attack in the past cause congestive heart failure? Yes. There are many different things that also cause congestive heart failure. You can have a valve problem where a valve is leaking too much, or is stenotic, or it's narrowed too much. That can cause congestive heart failure. People, as they get older, the hearts get more stiff, and we get something called diastolic dysfunction. And that can cause diastolic heart failure. So with heart failure, there's two different types. There's systolic and diastolic. Systolic is that the pump doesn't squeeze very well. And diastolic is where the heart or the pump doesn't relax very well. And so you can get fluid building up either way. And as we get older, we all develop diastolic dysfunction, where the heart doesn't relax very well. And so we can develop congestive heart failure from that. So there is that. But if you control all the other risk factors, you push it off as long as you can. And that's really what this is. Even with heart disease, I mean, if we live long enough, we will all develop heart disease. But we want to keep our quality of life as long as possible and push it off to our 90s or 100 if we get that far before that happens.
Mm-hmm. But I still keep in mind, you know, the statistic that you started out with this talk, which is 1 in 4 women will die of heart disease.
Correct.
1 in 4. So that is very high. That's like, okay, wake up, everybody. Red alert. We need to pay attention.
Yeah. And I think, you know, a lot of the news out there is, you know, especially for women, is get your mammogram, get your pap smear. It's not have your heart checked, get your blood pressure checked, all those things. I think we need to do more of a whole body type treatment for women, because we're all the same.
Yeah.
Yes, we might have different things that cause different things to happen, but we all have the same things that get us in the end. And we really need to worry about
Margaret Buckley Brown asks, is lipoprotein A an accurate measure of increased likelihood of heart disease, and should it be measured regularly at a particular age?
Lipoprotein A is one, if someone has extremely high cholesterol, and we're talking like a total cholesterol above 500. Normal people have total cholesterols in the 1 to 200s. If it's above 500, there are reasons that are genetic, like having a low level of lipoprotein A or a high level of lipoprotein A can be. If you're not one of those people, it's not recommended by the American College of Cardiology to check lipoprotein A except for once. Mm-hmm. And that's
because then you're in that special category.
Correct.
Like. Yeah. Okay. That makes sense. So this is from Beth Barnett. Hi, Beth. Can you clarify the meaning of heart disease in relation to heart attack? The symptoms you describe that require emergency treatment seem to be the symptoms of heart attack, but you're saying heart disease. Would you consider hypertension to be heart disease?
Hypertension is not heart disease. It's high blood pressure. Heart disease, heart attack, it's a spectrum is kind of the best way of putting this. Mm-hmm. You can have heart disease, which is a blockage in the artery, in one of the three arteries to the heart. That blockage can be 10% and cause no symptoms. It can be 50% and cause, if you're really overexerting yourself, You could get symptoms, but usually it's 70% or more is when we actually start getting symptoms of heart disease. And then when the, so part of that spectrum is that you can have angina, which is when you have 70% or more blockage of one of the arteries, which is the chest pain, the shortness of breath, whatever the pain between your shoulder blades. That's part of the spectrum. And that can go all the way up to 100% blockage, which is when you have a heart attack. And so it's just a spectrum. They're all the same. So that's kind of the best way of thinking of it.
And please check my note-taking here. Maggie Pheasant asked total normal cholesterol, and I had said under 120 for no symptoms and under 100 for symptoms. Is that what you said?
Under 120 if you have no risk factors, and under 100 if you have risk factors.
Gotcha. Okay. I was
close. If you have symptoms, you need to get checked to see why you have blockages, and then the number will get much lower if you actually do have blockages.
From Roseanne Gazelle, do the heart scans offered by places like Heart Check America have any value? And I've never heard of that, so.
The heart scans, that is where they go and you do a CT scan, where they take a CT scan of your chest and they look for calcium. You get a calcium score. And mm-hmm. a normal calcium score is 3, is 0 to 3. The higher that calcium score goes, the higher likelihood you might have blockages of the arteries. They are good. I think that they're reasonable. I don't think there's something you should do every year because it's a lot of radiation. Mm-hmm. But you know, if you're worried and you have things and you get a 0 score, great. Problem is with them is that they don't work very well for people under the age of 50, because you haven't had time to put calcium down in the blockages. Over the age of 50, you have more time to put calcium down, which is what they're looking for. Mm-hmm. I also will just give a caveat. I had one patient many years ago who had a score of 17,000. And we didn't even do a stress test on her. We just said, look, we're going to take you to the cath lab, do an angiogram, see what's going on. When we put the fluoro or the x-ray on to take a look at her heart and see where the tube was going, we could actually see the outlines of her arteries completely, because she had calcium all the way around all of her arteries. And when we shot the dye into the arteries, they were pristine normal. So there are some false positives, which is with every test. Yeah. But we still treated her as if she had coronary disease, and we put her on a statin, got her blood pressure under control, but she didn't have any blockages. So it just, that's what you have to worry sometimes with these tests. You also need to have, you know, just take a, do the full due diligence with them.
So Ruth Drazen asks, is it true that disease of the cardiac arteries is unrelated from disease of the heart muscle itself?
Yes. The disease of the heart muscle can be caused by blockages of the arteries. When you have a heart attack, you can damage the muscle. But you can also have damaging of the muscle from viruses. You can have damaging of the muscles from valvular problems. There's just multiple causes for damaging to the muscle itself, where the arteries is just basically a plaque that's filled with cholesterol. That's what it is. And the other interesting thing is that most heart attacks are caused not by blockages of 70% or more where you would have symptoms. They're actually caused by the 10 to 20% blockages that become unstable and rupture acutely.
Can you talk a little bit more about that? That's surprising. That's a surprising comment.
It is a surprising comment. So basically what is thought is that, so let me take a step back. So they did autopsy studies during the Vietnam War of our GIs who died in war. Mm-hmm. We found that the first beginnings of heart disease is something called fatty streaks, and it starts about the age of 18. So we get these fatty streaks in our arteries to our heart. And then that's the stage zero is what we call it, where it's the beginnings of it, but you don't see it unless you actually do an autopsy. And then the first stage is when you start getting, as the fatty streaks turn into blockages, where you can actually get a plaque, and that can be anywhere between 1% to 100%. What we're finding now is that the inflammatory states of high blood pressure, diabetes, smoking, being overweight, and all of that, and the autoimmune disorders and things can cause a destabilization of that plaque. And what happens is that the inflammatory state causes the plaque to then become unstable, and then it ruptures. And when it opens up, it forms a large, exposes a large clot forming material. But for whatever reason, that's what it really is that they found that it's 10 to 20% is what normally is what is there, unless people have had symptoms prior to their heart attack.
So people might feel like you have low risk factor, when in fact, even the beginnings of plaque are destabilizing potentially. I mean, that is a reason to pay closer attention and not watch and wait so much. If you're somebody who doesn't like to do a lot of interventions or doesn't like to take a lot of medicines, that's a very interesting point, I think.
Yeah, I mean, the old adage, a stitch in time saves nine, is very true when it comes to heart disease. I mean, you really want to treat your risk factors, be proactive, because really what it is that, you know, no one gets out of here alive. We all die at some point. And it's not always about the number of years we have in our life. It's all about the quality of those years. And if you are proactive and do the best you can, you will have more quality years of your life in terms of heart disease, or pretty much in terms of everything with our health, not just heart disease. And I think that's something that we all have to think about.
So Chris, I know two very young people who died of heart cancer. Can you just very briefly, I know it's rare, but the fact that I know two people, I think is so funny. And
Was it actually primary cardiac cancer, or was
the one was, yeah, and he was right out of my son's he was in my son's college graduation class, and he died 2 months later. And it was not diagnosed until, you know, right before he died.
That's really rare. I've never seen a case, to be honest with you.
Okay.
Actually had a question on my boards said, what was the one organ that doesn't have primary cancer? And it was actually the heart, because it is so rare.
So it probably wasn't primary.
Most of the time it's secondary. Most of the time it's, you know, skin cancer, melanoma, breast cancer, lung cancer that invades, you know, from an extension. That's usually what happens. So
thank you.
No problem.
So we have a question from Maggie Buckley. What is the CHA2DS2 vascular score, and when should a patient be concerned or push for additional evaluation or treatment? I don't know what that is.
Is that me? Okay. Oh, Chad Vas. Okay. So Chad's VAS score, that is actually not for coronary artery disease. That is for atrial fibrillation. What that is if you have a score of 1 or 0 for a Chad's VAS score, if you have atrial fibrillation, the risk of being on anticoagulation is low. If you have 2 or more, they would recommend you be on anticoagulation permanently with atrial fibrillation. And it's basically a risk of stroke in the presence of atrial fibrillation.
Okay. And Patsy Stahl asked, if the plaque ruptures, would the clot then be identified as a stroke rather than a heart attack?
No, because if the plaque ruptures and forms a clot, it stays local in the artery that it happens. Can you have a plaque in your brain that can cause a stroke the same way? Yes. We see that a lot, especially in the carotid arteries, where you'll have blockages in the arteries that lead up into your head. They can form and close off, or they can actually break loose some of the plaque from there that cause a stroke. But usually it's just local within the area of where the plaque is.
We have Barbara Bree asking, is AF, I'm thinking that it's atrial fibrillation hereditary.
It hasn't been proven to be hereditary, except for in certain, genetic disorders. So I would say no, just the short answer. Okay. It's risks of developing atrial fibrillation, high blood pressure, alcohol consumption, age. So it's more likely nurture than nature in mm-hmm. this aspect.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of alcohol, is that also a risk factor in heart disease?
In terms of blockages, no. There's something called the French paradox, which is an interesting comment. The French still smoke quite a bit, but they drink a lot of red wine. And they tend to have one of the lowest rates of heart disease in the world. They also die of liver cancer, cirrhosis.
And they also eat cheese too, right? I mean, full fat cheese. So.
Yeah.
What the heck?
Creams with their sauces and all that stuff. It's quite interesting. But there is something within red wine that has a, 1 to 2 glasses of red wine 3 times a week is what the American College of Cardiology will allow anybody to say is beneficial. But it all depends on people also. You have to weigh the other risks of, liver disease and all of that. So.
Interesting. So we just have a few more minutes here. So any remaining questions, please throw them in the chat. And Chris, is there anything that you'd like to just emphasize in terms of when we're talking to our doctors or advocating for our clients? Just, good questions or framing, especially around women's heart disease.
I mean, I really think really pushing, to have women talk about with their doctors their, pregnancy-related illnesses, mm-hmm. I think is a very big thing. I mean, I was never taught that. Over the last 5 years, a friend of mine who's an OBGYN is like, why didn't you ever ask about these things? It's like, you're not really, you were never taught. As the research is being done, it is much more a very prominent thing that we need to know about women's health. And I think that that is one of the biggest things that I push. And then just push to know what your cholesterol levels are, what's your risk from that. Talk to them about what your LDL is. And know what your blood pressure things in. And if you are smoking, try to stop, and don't start vaping.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. One last question from Kate Smith, Alzheimer's connection and heart disease. Is there a connection?
There's no, again, this is going to be correlation versus causation.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody who is older does have heart disease and they're more likely to get Alzheimer's or have Alzheimer's at that time. Is it a causation or a correlation? It's hard to say. But what I can say is that if you're on a statin to lower your cholesterol to help prevent your things, there are studies that show it reduces your risk of getting Alzheimer's also.
Mm-hmm. And to close us out, I'm going to put you on the spot. Who is speaking next month at Community Conversation? Who is our speaker?
Next month is my very good friend, Angela Chen. She's an OBGYN at Evergreen. She also works on a Project Birth, with Harvard University. And she'll be speaking on menopause.
Fantastic. Treatments. Look forward to that. And thanks everybody for joining us today. If you did pay for CE, you'll be receiving a follow-up Survey Monkey that you need to fill out in order to get the CE. So watch for that. And for everybody else, we always appreciate your feedback. So thanks so much, Chris, for leading us.
Thank you, Chris. That was great.
On this talk.
No problem.
All right. We'll see everybody next month. Nice to see you.